Well, it's still saying I'm offline. Stop streaming, start recording. Interesting, I'm streaming. Am I really streaming? Come on. Get with me, buddy. Are you streaming? Still saying I'm offline. There we go. Okay. Now we're streaming. Now we're live. That's what we like to see. So, anyway, now that I'm actually, in fact, on the interwebs, let me get the old schnazzaroonie going again for the countdown. And, yeah, so, like I was saying, we have a lot of stuff going on with the stream today. Our characters are in quite a predicament. They are truly racing for their lives back to the safety of the caravan that they went sightseeing off a couple days ago from. It's been a heck of a day for them, and we'll see exactly how this all works out. For those of you who are unfamiliar with our channel, we do run the channel 100% for charity. This month's charity, we change charity every month. This month's charity is 826LA. If you are a critter or watch Critical Role, you might be familiar with it. But it's a really great charity. You can read more about it down the doobly-doo. They encourage creative writing for folks, for school systems that aren't able to really reinforce the arts as much. And so, since creative writing is such a huge part of Dungeons & Dragons, and certainly in a homebrew world like The Vice, I thought it'd be a great thing for us to support this month. So, that's what we're doing. We gave ourselves a pretty lofty goal of $500. I was doing a matching up to the first $150. We've had about another $150+. Dollars worth of donations, so we're sitting at about 330. Not sure if we'll make it to 500, but every dollar counts, and we're just happy to have anyone tune in and watch and give to a what we believe is a great cause. So if you're able to, that would be great. Every little bit helps. If you'd like to donate directly because of your tax purposes or whatever, totally understand that too. You can let me know that you have, and we can do it that way, or just do it to be, you know, a good citizen of the world. That's fine too. Hey, Sprocketeer, how you doing? But anyway, if you do donate, you can affect our game. We've had some items that have come into play over the last couple of sessions that have really affected our gameplay. In fact, one of our original ones, which was sort of a joke piece, the Mirror of Peeping has now become a plot point out there. You want to get a part in our game, sort of have a little piece of yourself in the world of the Vice, hop on in, throw a couple dollars towards 826LA, and, you know, we'd love to do what we can to write you in. Two items this month, two donation levels this month, are for creative writing-based items. One of them is for a Vice Magic Surge. For those of you who've been watching the stream for the last couple of episodes, back when our group was fighting the Green Dragonflight Syndicate, they had a double fault on a spell which caused a Vice Magic Surge. They are finding more and more about these strange magical surges that are affecting the land, and with that, you're able to help me create a table. Right now it's up to about 120 different magical effects of all types and shapes and whatever suits your fancy. The other one is to actually create a homebrew monster for the Vice, which is a area within our world that eventually our players are going to have to encounter, or we believe they'll be encountering, depending on some of the choices that they make. And I'm homebrewing up monsters for in there. So that is certainly something you can do as well if you would like to flex your own creative writing muscles as well. So yeah, that's all wonderful and great things you can do. Hey, Astrodubs, Hey, what's this about? It is a D&D 5e game. This is episode 10, I believe. Gosh, we're already on episode 10. It's a whole group of, I have seven players, and I'm sorry, six players, but plus myself, that are traversing through this world. Today there is a couple, they are running in a mad dash from some hounds that were tracking down one of the members of the party. And while they killed them, actually two episodes ago, they realized that these clockwork mechanisms were not truly dead. They are sort of possessed by fiendish energy. And since they do not have any holy people with them, they are making a mad dash back towards a caravan where they have a paladin friend. So we've got a sort of race for your life. Charlie Brown, sorry, I'm a child of the age, 70s and 80s, to try to make it to the relative safety, or what they believe to be safety, or at least someplace where they think they're going to have a chance to fight off these hounds, these clockwork hounds that are pursuing them. While I got a minute or two, I would like to go ahead and throw out some props to folks who have followed in the last couple of days. Path Lovecraft followed just a couple days ago, along with Akiba First, and we've got two more with RPG James and Eli Moon, who have both joined in and followed us. So I do appreciate them joining us on the Vice. We got about 7 minutes before the game gets started. If you have any questions, or like I said, if you haven't watched before, we do have all of our episodes on YouTube, on my channel there, which is Tall Squall as well, and some highlights from our episodes, some of the great improv and character work that our players have done over the last 10 sessions, 9 sessions. And a couple of the highlight reels down there as well, so you can kind of get an idea of how we play. Those folks who are familiar with Critical Role, we do have a very narrative-heavy game, lots of story, or at least we try to keep it lots of story. We do also have, of course, combat and those types of things, because it is D&D. We do a lot of theater of the mind as well. A couple shout-outs. Another shout-out I'd like to do is for our buddy... Lloyd Hagosha, not Hagosha, Hagosha is my old DM. Lloyd Hoshida, who did the artwork that you're seeing, that is actually our party that we got a commission of. And he does amazing work, great to work with as far as pretty much anything you could want. Astrobus, you're playing D&D soon on stream with other players, and what's your tune? I'm the DM, but we have, like I said, the six other players, and I'll be switching screens soon. They're hiding in the background right now behind what's going on. Hey, thanks, Path Lovecraft. Yeah, no, thank you for the follow, and hope you enjoy seeing what we do here. It's a little bit different, not quite as crazy as Encounter Roleplay, at least not all the time, but sometimes it is. Like I said, we have something called the Mirror of Peeping, which lets you peep into outhouses, so yeah. Anyway, we have quite a few players that are going to be introducing themselves in just about 5 minutes, and what characters and classes that they will be playing. So, okay, Good Guy Pie's a little bit late. That's good to know. Anyway, so that is kind of what we've got going on. Yeah, victims, yes. Templar Warden, you are my victims. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. But one of the other things that's kind of cool, we've got Lloyd Hoshida, who does our art. The music you are listening to right now actually was composed by one of our players. It is all original compositions by our player Toonarth, Danny, out in California, and he has started to write themes for each of our characters, as well as for some of our bardic spells that are playing a big part in the game. So, yeah. I want to play D&D soon on Roll20 because maybe everyone... Yeah, no, I can tell you, I tried to keep a live game going here in town, but, you know, it just kind of fell apart because of schedules and everything. Roll20, I find to be a great way to play, and there's something about also, I mean, I think even our the folks who are doing it professionally these days, like Roll20 and High Rollers and some of those have said, you know, it really is when you've got a stream that you know you're going to be at, you know, and it's on your schedule as such. You know, for the most part, we haven't missed a game or have been able to work around people's schedules to make it work with what they have going on. But Roll20 is a great way to do it. Look for in the looking for a group portion of their program. And and also if you're a new player, new players welcome area as well. So. Anyway, yeah, that's kind of what we got going on. I'm trying to think if there's other stuff that I need to fill you guys in on. That's pretty much it as far as the station goes. If you want to see, we actually raised money for the Dana and Christopher Reeves Foundation over December and January. That was very successful. We had a great time with it. We have something that's actually still in play in the game. Several players have them, called a Kryptonian Gym, which gives you a power of Superman or an attribute of Superman as a short-term effect. We try to keep it not 100% traditional 5e. Again, we've got a lot of narrative things going on with this world. So, excuse me. So I don't completely talk my voice away before I even get the game started. But, that's pretty much what we got going here. About 2 minutes and we will get started. I actually am going to go ahead and swap us over soon. Knowing one of my players is late means that my cameras are not going to automatically pop into place. So let me get my players ready so they understand that they're about to be live, even though we're going a little early. And, hey guys, we're going to go ahead and go a little bit early since a good guy saying he's going to be late. I'm going to need to adjust cameras. So I'm going to go ahead and pop us over here in just a second. I just need to get rid of my camera on this one and then we'll go. So we will hop over in just a second and go to scene and all the wonderful cameras, all a mess. So, as you can see, I need to mess with my cameras so that we can actually see everybody, but then we will get going with the play. These are our cast members. You guys can enter our chat, say hello, do whatever you'd like to do. Thoughts about today's session, how worried are you on a scale of 1 to 10? All those good type of things while I'm playing with cameras.
I'm going to be the positive one. I think we will all be perfectly fine.
I actually think so as well, to be honest, in that we have done this fight before. Admittedly, we are now wounded and had run across the entire plains, and it's going to be difficult, but we've survived already. We have the skills.
Very good. That's a nice positive outlook.
Admittedly, he could just do something horrible and we all die. So
I was going to say,
And they keep saying he's nervous, which does not give us additional confidence by any stretch of the imagination. But
yeah, because if he's nervous, that means he has something big planned and he's hoping it goes off well. But well for whom is the question?
Correct. Look at our insightful player there.
Hey, did we all make our sacrifice to the dice gods today? Because last time it didn't go so well.
I got up too late.
I have an 18 wisdom, so.
Danny and I killed a lot of pigs last night, so we should be good.
Yeah.
What were you Minecrafting?
No. Blood and bacon. Blood and bacon.
Blood and bacon, golly.
Bacon for the bacon god.
Bacon for the bacon god? That works too.
It was Askren's birthday.
Gotcha. Nice. But, it's going to be interesting. We'll see. There are critical pieces of information that we have about that are coming going forward, and it's going to be great. And yes, I am nervous. I'm nervous for you guys. I'm nervous for what y'all are going to do. That's the problem.
It's we're going to kill each other.
Why I can't... You know, if I could just give you all scripts and be like, okay, here's how y'all are going to react, and this is how this is all going to go, it'd be so much easier. But that's not how D&D works. You all actually get to, like, you know, have input into how I make your lives miserable.
Well, that's a cool shirt, whatever it is.
Actually, this is from World of Harry Potter. This is... it's Phoenix. It's a fox.
Fox, nice.
I figure it was with our resurrecting hounds. It was an interest. It would be a fun choice for today, having
too soon,
a
man.
Phoenix.
Yes, how majestic.
Yes.
Okay. Note to self: pay attention to the shirts for clues.
Believe it or not, you know it's funny. I have actually pretty much every week my shirts have been themed to the story, and I don't know if if people have noticed, but yeah, no, I definitely. And do theming t-shirts.
Because I have keep an eye out for that Metallica Kill Them All album cover.
So would you call them theme shirts?
Okay, that counts. That counts as your pun of the week. You're done.
No, it doesn't.
You're done.
No, it is not. No, it is not.
Unfortunately,
that is off the cuff. That is not my pun of the week. I have my pun of the week ready.
I think we're coming apart at the themes here.
killing me. It's like, why do I even let you guys on my station, man?
Can they hear us in the stream right now?
Yeah, they should be able to.
Yeah, they're all gone. Sorry.
They're gone now. Yeah, no one, no one's around anymore. So I'm gonna have to play with the cameras again once we get to that place when Lux shows up. But with that, it's 12:02, so let's go ahead and get started, guys. Let's do a quick introduction. There is a lot to do today. So quick introduction, who you are, who you're playing. Let's go ahead and start with Bird.
I am Bird versus Plane. I am playing Iska Tol, a half-elf bard lady who quests for, knowledge, song, entertainment, and who has unwittingly released these three resurrecting mechanical hounds on the party. My bad, guys.
Luna, NNG9, Alicia, yes. All those different names that you have.
All of them. I am NNG9. I play Luna, who is a Genasi monk. And today's going to be interesting and fun and have less water, which I'm kind of sad about. But what you going to do?
This is true. Very true. Let's go ahead and go to Tunarth.
I am Tunarth. I am playing Kel, the wood elf druid, and we're not in the woods anymore. We're out of the woods and onto the plains, and I'm a little uncomfortable and racked with guilt because I fell asleep at the switch, metaphorically speaking, and let the party be surprised by aforesaid mechanical hounds. And so, yeah, not good. Not good.
Jeanette.
Let me unmute myself. I play I am Dragon Druid. I play Celia, who is a high elf rogue. She has not really connected with much of the party except for Luna, obviously, because she feels protective over her. She's not really, she doesn't trust easily. So the fact that she's traveling with this entire party and trusting them to take care of not only herself, but this person that she wants to protect a lot, is definitely something for her.
Okay, and last but not least, Templar Warden.
So, I am Templar Warden. I am playing Hidden by Axel, or just Axel, the Tabaxi, the very energetic Tabaxi cat dude. Wizard. He had a little bit of a rough past. He was, his family was killed. He was found by a wizard and raised by this hermit wizard. But he always had sort of a wanderlust and a curiosity. So now he gets out, and all the energy now, he wants to get out and see the world. And he comes across first Luna, then the three others, first Luna, then Iska, Kel, and Luck. And, these are like some of the first people he's met outside of just his mentor and a couple of other people. And, instantly wants to make friends. Then eventually they met Celia, and he's got a lot of. He feels like he has a kindred. There's a kindred spirit between Axel and Iska, you know, in many ways. So yeah, he's with this sort of new family for him, really. The beginnings of a new family for Axel, and now we are running for our lives.
Pretty much. I'm going to do a fairly quick recap so we can hop right into it. It's been a hell of a last couple of days. It started off with a storm that sort of tore a caravan apart that they were traveling with. Then they did sort of have a uneventful day as they traveled to a place called the Tears of Tiamat to see this natural wonder that they had heard about. Upon arriving there, they met a weird little golem-esque type guy who told them that there were gifts waiting for them that had been given by these hot spring pools where they found some mysterious crystals and other things. As they camped out for the night to watch the eruption of this giant geyser called Bahamut's Breath, similar to sort of Old Faithful in Yellowstone. Hey, Big Bestie, how you doing? Kel had a distracting vision, a vision that intrigued him very much, but also unfortunately distracted him a bit. And as he said, he, while was trying to pay attention to some new, what is it called, sensory inputs that he kind of had, he missed the pickup on the fact that these hounds, who they had been warned about by Iska in a vision, were sneaking up on them to ambush them. And right before dawn, they were in fact ambushed. That's dawn of the day that we are in now. They were ambushed by these hounds. Eked out a narrow defeat after a couple of the party members did get knocked unconscious and were pretty severely injured. Then proceeded to go down into the depths of the pool here that Bahamut's Breath erupts out of, called the Eye of Eternity, and went in and explored a temple dedicated to knowledge, which ended up giving several boons to our wizard Axel. And also at the end of their adventures in the temple was revealed that this was actually a test for him to his first test to earn his right to become a member of the Eternal Keepers, who are one of the secret organizations that sort of keep the secrets of this land. As they got back to the surface, they realized, somewhat from the lessons that they learned in the temple and also sort of the hopelessness of their situation, these three hounds who had all but killed them the first time were still possessed by demons. And from Iska's vision of them several episodes ago, that under the light of the moon, they tend to resurrect even worse than they were before. And with that, our party quickly gathered up all of their belongings and in no uncertain terms are pretty much racing their way across the Dragon Gust Plains, following the stream known as the Rainbow Stream, which is sort of the runoff from this geyser, because they have been told that that leads them to the Verdant Falls, where they can hook back up with their caravan, and most importantly, with their paladin, their older, sort of retired paladin adventurer friend, Stroth, who they believe could have some boons to help them out with the situation they found themselves in. With that, I am going to turn it over to the party. You guys are kind of on the run, so to speak. So you do have, as you look out across the plains, it is, you know, a sort of long sloping run. I mean, you can see for miles that the elevation is getting lower and lower as you look out across these plains, very similar to the picture that I have up on Roll20. I claim that I've got you all on the right screen on Roll20. I do. So you can see, you know, in front of you and behind you truly for miles. Behind you, you can see sort of the mound, as you saw it when you were approaching it, of Tiamat's Tears, where all of the minerals and such from the geyser over the centuries and eons has built up this sort of large mound behind you, about 20 or 30 feet high. And then this just really, really long sloping plain in front of you with the creek, a little more than a creek stream, the rainbow stream flowing straight ahead, pretty much directly to the south. As you look down at it, you do quickly realize why it is called the Rainbow Stream. Pretty much wherever the water eddies or goes around large rocks or boulders or formations in it, you can see where the minerals from the pools, the tears of Tiamat, and the different various colors, red, green, black, white, blue, and even some of the deeper pools, that same sort of rainbow coloration that you saw in the Eye of Eternity, little miniature versions of that as you go along this stream. It's about, right now, I'd say it's probably, you know, 9 o'clock in the morning. You've been walking for about an hour after leaving the Tears of Tiamat, and your destination is as clear as you know. Follow the stream, get to the falls.
Well, I'm presuming we're just going to start booking it. Mm-hmm. Just follow the stream and go as fast as we collectively can.
Long Strider. Oh, wait, no.
I mean, we had already gathered all of our stuff. We were about to start making the run, so.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm saying you're about an hour outside of Tiamat's tears at this point, that you, the stress of getting, you know, sort of out the door, down the path, through the scree to find your way. So I'd say it's about an hour outside of that. You know, you've gone a mile, maybe a mile and a half, just following the stream. There is a pathway here. It's not it's sort of a goat trail. It's not a big roadway or anything like that, but obviously has been used in the past to make this same sort of jaunt across the Dragon Gust Plains.
Well, unless anybody else has any objections, I don't think we're going to be. Are we even going to stop at some point for a lunch break, or just go?
I think the one most likely to stop us for a lunch break would be Luck, but even that, I mean, Luck's idea of this thing is a demon of some sort or needs to have radiant damage to kill it. I think, like, we would be going, and I know Iska is going to, like, want to push this party forward. Iska already feels this. I know Kel feels guilt. Iska already, like, has been having this, like, huge just burden of guilt weigh down on her for putting everyone in this position. And now it's, you know, still early in the morning and we're all like basically tapped. And if we encounter anything, we're kind of screwed. So Iska's definitely advocating for pushing.
Anyone else? Axel, anything? You've probably had the most eventful morning after your all of your encounters in the temple. Anything of interest you would like to add, or are you just
probably quickly before he left, he would have taken notes on like the runes on the Mirror of Peeping. He was just like, it's like they're incredibly messy, but they're quick notes. Then he sort of wraps them up, puts them away, and then runs off. And now he's on another task right now. Get back to it later if he ever gets back to it. He's not really pulling ahead or going any faster than, but he's on all fours, sort of loping along. He'll move away from the bit from the group, take a look out, and come back and sort of thing. He's still pretty close, but he keeps with the group and particularly close to Iska.
So yeah, anything that you're up to?
Other than just traveling, no.
No, Celia. I'm sorry.
Celia.
Celia's just doing her rogue thing, keeping to the shadows, but moving along with the group.
Okay. So you all continue on for the next couple hours through lunch. You do encounter some of the animals that you've seen before. out here in the Dragon Guest Plains. Coyote kind of comes and see what's going on. But for the most part, yeah, you guys are keeping moving well into the afternoon.
I do want to make note of any other animals that we encounter that I have never seen before.
Nothing that you didn't encounter before. You know, it's that same sort of list of things. This is very much the same region that you were in before. The only thing of just ecological note, there are some very colorful salamanders and frogs that seem to have adapted to the bright colorations of the rainbow stream, sort of a micro ecosystem there. You don't stop long enough to, investigate them or lick them or anything like that, but they are very they are very colorful and seem to have adapted to this environment where they are living amongst.
But they appear to be some kind of variation of frogs and lizard types that I've seen.
Yeah, salamander, frog, just that they have a local ecological adaptation for camouflage.
Mental note that it might be fun to turn into a rainbow frog at some point.
Hey, it's a, I mean, yeah.
Just remember, it's not easy being green.
These are like red and pink and purple and, some, seem to be able to blend across the different stratification lines of the gems. Morning sort of starts to turn to later in the afternoon. I need everyone to make me a constitution check. It's not a saving throw. It's just seeing how you guys are doing with... This is a pretty tough march. And y'all have had a heck of a morning.
Wow.
Guys, we're so good.
It has been a morning, guys.
I am fine.
Coffee. It just...
Because, Axel's Axel.
Axel's Axel.
God, with four failures, you guys got to stop. You're wiped. It's about 4 in the afternoon. Y'all have been going nonstop. We'll say Iska says it first because she has the lowest roll of just I'm terrified or however you want to say it, but you've got to ask the group to stop for at least a moment.
Yeah, Iska will definitely breathing heavy, probably similar feeling to what she had down there in the temple when she lost her breath. And there's a good guy.
Yes, there is.
Cool, y'all can go through this while I fix all the cameras again.
Nice.
Two scenes.
No, perfect timing.
Yeah, Iska kind of begins to break down a little bit, losing her breath, legs kind of giving out from underneath of her, and it's clear she wants to continue going onward because that's the Iska spirit is always forward, go, 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 but just the body is not able to do what the mind wants, so her knees kind of buckle and she falls. And she doesn't actually call out and say wait or stop, but she does let out an audible kind of grunt and just looks to the rest of the party, trying to still keep up.
I immediately go over to her and help her up, but then look to see if there's some place we can rest and say, we're going to rest. We need to rest. We're all exhausted.
Do me a nature check, Kel, to see what you see.
Why is it always nature? Why can't it be survival?
Because sometimes it's not about survival.
No!
Hey, 19 nature check. Yeah, I mean, you see there's basically a nice sort of eddy. A willow tree has grown up, so there's some shade. It is, blue skies, and, it's getting warmer as y'all have been moving south. So it's been a warm day. There is a willow tree for some shade, some larger big flat rocks that you guys could, just sit on and just catch your breath at this point.
I take her over and I say, we're stopping. We have to stop.
Did I'm not tied. I could sort of Axel's sort of going to try and figure out roughly, you know, how, does he have any concept of how far they've gone and how far they need to go?
Unfortunately, pretty much the only real piece of information you have about how far it is that it was a, you know, a true full day's travel. As Tohir had said, you know, he pretty much said that it was, you know, a good full day travel to get to the Verdant Falls from the Tears of Tiamat. So, you know, y'all been going booking pretty good. You started out at about 8 in the morning. You know, you're not really, you know, you have learned from the caravanners when they talk about a full day, they truly mean a full day because they're used to caravan travel, which you don't have as, you know, if you have to rest, you hop up on a wagon, but the caravan keeps moving. So also caravan moves a little bit faster than you guys do because the horses and everything else. So you are not seeing, actually doing a perception check.
Yep. Rolling good today.
Yeah, even with a 21, you know, you're not, you can see, again, it's a very clear, long, straight shot of open, wide open country, but you're not seeing anything in front of you that looks like, you know, deviation in the landscape where there would be a falls or there would be, you know, a something, you know, where this stream ends, you just see it's, you know, going down, 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 and don't really see anything in particular yet. I mean, it's about 4 in the afternoon, like I said, but you're not seeing anything that seems like you're closing in on your destination yet.
Okay.
I'm presuming we need to take a short rest here.
Yep. You can call this a short rest. So whatever benefits you get from a short rest, knowing that this is about your third short rest of the day. So if it's only a one-time short rest thing, you don't, you know, you all have not had a long rest since before the dogs attacked you the first time. So, but y'all've got 15 minutes, or we'll say 30 minutes, because since with 4 constitution rolls under a 10, yeah, it's gonna take about 30 minutes for y'all to get your breath back. You can break out if anyone's got a little, you know, maybe break out some rations, anything like that to try to food and bev.
Can I use some? Oh no, I can't. I even used, like, I've used everything. I have nothing. I was gonna use some hit dice, but I did that the last time.
Yep.
God. All right.
I have a quick question because I cannot remember when we got out of the temple. Did we retrieve our things before
yes.
we booked
oh,
it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We made sure. My violin. Anyway,
yeah, everyone made a big point.
No, I had to. Okay.
I know.
We wanted to make sure because I'm like, if we didn't, she doesn't have rations.
Yeah. I would say, well, no, most of you all left are non-essentials up there, so I won't say none of them. You didn't have anything get destroyed from, you know, from the water slide. But since you all left most of the non-essentials up in dry land.
Okay. Luna will, of course, make sure everybody stays hydrated.
Yeah, if you're able to create water, Rainbow Stream is probably fine to drink, but y'all don't know for sure. So, but if you can either create or you pull it from there, your way, whatever you would prefer.
Okay.
So about 30 minutes go by. Anything else that you guys want to do while you are there? Hey, Luck, actually do me a constitution check just to see whether you needed the rest as well or whether you were... whether you've got energy to do something else. With a 14, you've actually got some energy. You've got, if there's anything that you would like to do. Good Guy Pie, he plays Luck. He's a blood hunter. He was running a little bit late, but he's here now. So anything specific? We just did a quick, anything special you're wanting to do on this journey? I assume luck being luck. It's kind of how you described it.
Yeah, luck being luck, full speed ahead.
Just while you're here, because it was a big rush, do y'all redistribute your packs? I know Luna pretty much was carrying everything because she had the empty space, the empty dry space. Do y'all redistribute? There's a cloak. There's all 70 pounds of gem ore that y'all are hauling, which might have been part of your constitution problem. You know, you've got, I'm trying to think what else y'all picked up down there. I think that's mainly it, the ore and that. I assume you give back violin, all that type of stuff.
Yeah. So. Yeah. The violin was like the first thing I did. Yeah. I gave that back.
So I'll probably take at least 3/4 of the ore. I'll probably want to take it all, to be honest.
Actually, we'll take a sample and he'll probably actually like
you are fairly well constitution wise. I mean, you've got 30 minutes to work on the ore if you'd like to try to start pulling the gems.
Yeah, why not? Whatever else.
Did it weigh the amount that he had?
I went back and looked because I forgot too. It was 10 pounds per thing and you had 7 things that you killed. So you have you had 70 pounds of ore.
Axel would have taken the one he'd taken out.
Oh, right. A couple you said you got. I mean, Luna got a specific gem that I think the one vomited on her.
Yes. Axel, that one I wanted.
Yeah. Axel got a specific one as well. Yep. I will roll. I've got a table. We won't worry about it now. I can tell you exactly what it was. Luck, roll me a mining tools check again with advantage because you are a miner. You get through quite a bit of it. We'll say that you eliminate most of the rock. You haven't really gone through and identified a lot of the gems, but we'll say that it's down to, you've reduced it from 70 pounds to 35 pounds because you've been able to take more time within 30 minutes before you did this whole thing, like in 10. So you didn't take a lot of time of getting rid of excess rock. You now use your little mining tools and picks to get it knocked out, and now it's only about 35 pounds, so that should help as well as you move forward. With that, do you guys get up and get back on the road? I'm not going to make you do a constitution check with advantage or anything. We're going to say that y'all recovered in 30 minutes. Rations, knock them off. Yep. You knock them off of your rations chart, all that kind of stuff.
Yep. Who is carrying the gems now? I'll happily take them.
Besides the ones that me and Axel specifically called out, I'm not.
We'll say that you have it, Lux, since you were working on it, and so that you can work on it. You know, it's your knitting.
Yeah.
Yeah, Axel would take like some time before he manages to sort of settle down during this break, and then he would of course be over with Iska. Making sure she's all right and then sort of going around making sure everyone else is all right before, you know, he finally settles down and works on his notes again.
Okay.
For like a couple of minutes.
Yeah, and, you know, Axel, rainbow frogs, I'm just saying.
Yeah, rainbow frogs. Oh, gosh. Yeah, he manages to, I'm going to roll a perception, actually.
Okay.
Does he see them or not? Because if he does, then they'll probably take his attention.
And rainbow lizards.
Yep, I'd say with a 12 you see him. I mean, I'd say you had a 50-50 shot, so.
So he's quite intrigued by these things, and, you know, he's sort of trying to split his attention between making notes on the rune stones and the things in the mirror and the temple, and then it's like, oh, these things are cool. And he'll probably go and try and poke one of them, just like with the claw.
We'll say, Luna, you had advantage. You saw them too once you see Axel poking at him.
Yeah, you'll see him very interested in something by the stream right now during the break.
And, you know, that probably revitalizes Iska a little bit, gets some more of her.
No, I was actually going to bring it up earlier, and we just kind of moved on that she would have been, that would have been like flashes of like the classic Iska just seeing those things. But now, because her constitution was so low, let's say that her falling down was both a physical like and a bit of a mental breakdown. And now, like in this break, getting some recovery and then stopping to see like one rainbow frogs, which are incredibly like beautiful looking to her at least, and then two, like Axel being curious cat in playing is kind of like getting her back into that mindset of like, oh yeah, like this is what we need to like keep, we need to keep going for this reason.
Cool. So with that, you all get going and start heading on your way again down the stream. You know, about another 2 hours pass at six, the sun's getting pretty low in the sky. You know, you're still not seeing a whole lot of, you're getting there. It's getting about 7 o'clock. It's getting to be dusk. It's getting a little scary that that you're not seeing what you were hoping to see at this point. As it starts to approach 8 o'clock and the sun is just barely above the horizon still, I need all of you all to roll a perception check.
Kel knows what's up.
I don't see anything.
Yeah. So Kel, in the distance, and I think this is probably a lot because of your times that you have spent in the woods and waterfalls and how things work. Up in the far off in the distance, you see what you were sort of thinking was maybe a shadow of a cloud or something across the far horizon, just barely peeking over. You're now realizing that what it is, you're seeing the tops of the foliage of trees, that this is the dark canopy of a trees, and because they are at a lower level, you're just seeing the top of it. It just looked like it was another dark hill, but you're realizing now that, you know, however this fall goes over, it's far enough of a drop that basically the top of the canopies or the trees is all but level with sort of the plain that you've been walking along, and that's why it seemed almost invisible to you. And is that, go ahead.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I meant to ask before and I didn't, but obviously we've been heading downstream, which means Correct. That when we get there, we're going to be at probably the top of the falls.
Yes.
And have to figure out how to get down them, theoretically.
Yeah. Right.
Okay.
We can't water slide our way out of every problem.
Yes, you can.
I mean,
try hard enough.
We can try.
But we have trees.
On three jump.
But it depends on where the path comes in and whether the caravan's going to be at the bottom of the top or the top of the falls when we get there. Either way, it's about how far.
Best you can judge.
Is it from where
I would
we
say
are?
With your perception, it's a pretty good guess. 2 to 3 miles. I mean, it's still a good way away, but at least you see it. I mean, you're not close enough. You know, you again with that roll, you know that if you're seeing the tops of trees, that's a pretty good fall. And seeing the amount of water in this stream, while it's not huge, it's still a pretty good sized stream that, you know, you're not hearing a waterfall yet, which you know, that's giving you more idea of the distance than anything, is that, you know, you aren't hearing a 30 to 40 foot cascade of water yet. And from what you can see of that shadow, 2 to 3 miles easily. And as you get that glimpse, you know, all of you have been seeing all this time, you know, the full moon is up in the blue sky. You know, it's been up, you know, pretty much since 4 o'clock or so. So it's, as Axel remembered from his intelligence check, the moon was high in the sky when the sun went down. And as Kel relays what he sees to the party, it dips below the horizon, and you all sort of look behind you and can see the last sliver of light go across the mound far behind you now of Tiamat's tears. Luck, I need you to make a perception check with advantage. As the last bit of light disappears from Tiamat's tears, you feel something. And this time, you've always had that sort of low, dim feeling of fiendish energy. It is now spiked with undead energy as well. And as you look backwards, you see three red, almost look like tiny little stars with this sort of purple-black nimbus around them, leap up over the edge of Tiamat's tears. And more concerning, you see them wink out of existence and then appear a little bit larger and closer.
Oh dear, they're on the way, they're awake! The puppies are awake! This is not good. We must be ready for this one. They're awake, they're ready, and we know they're coming. This time they're not catching us by surprise.
Axel sort of,
you've come probably 8 to 10 miles at this point. You've got 2 miles to go to get where you're going, and they've got to cover that distance as well.
You've got 2 miles, roughly 2 miles, give or take a bit. We've got a nice head start on them.
Is it enough of a head start?
It is.
This might be a risky thing to suggest, but these hounds are after Iska.
Right.
You come with me and we run ahead.
Yes, yes.
And perhaps they'll pass the rest of you by and come after Iska.
No. We come with you, and then when we get there, we can talk to Stroth, and Stroth can help us.
But I can get there faster, and yes, I can get do her that, there faster. Yes. And I can get her there faster with me. And I become a warhorse.
Nice.
Dude!
Is it a white warhorse? Like a stallion?
No. Brown.
Cool.
Whoa!
So, you see...
And I waste no time. I'm just bam, horse. And I look back at Iska and gesture with my head.
Iska approaches you. Again, there's that sense of amazement. There's always that sense of amazement when
Luna is boosting you onto the horse.
Yeah,
I look right there as well.
I kind of stamp at the ground and
whinny.
Iska is. For your warhorse form is very light. You realize when she gets up on top of you that she is very light. Do you take off with her, or do you,
I wait for her. I kind of try to arch my neck back as best I can to indicate for her to grab the mane.
She clings on as tightly as she can. And
as soon as I feel like she's got a good enough grip, I go.
She looks at the rest of the party and just tries to catch a shot of them before...
I'm going to try and go as fast as I can, keeping in mind that I'm trying to do my best to keep her on my back as well.
Okay.
If I feel her slipping, I'm going to slow down just enough so she can recover.
I'm not even going to have you do a dexterity check just because your mount is intentionally keeping you on him. So, guys, you see Kel and Iska gallop full tilt down the stream. You guys, what do you guys do?
Keep going.
Hey, just because they're going faster than us doesn't mean we can't go fast ourselves. Quick.
Okay, so 2 miles on a war horse with a light person actually is pretty darn quick. So I'm going to jump to Iska and Kel here for a second, and then we will bring the others in as timing occurs. Nope, that's not the right thing. I need to do this. And I need to give me a second because I had everyone over there and all of you all aren't there yet. How do I do this without...
You mean you didn't expect us to split the party?
No, I can't say that it did. I got to figure out how to...
Best laid plans.
Revoke the first one.
Sorry.
Yeah, no, dude, I love it.
It makes sense.
Oh, no, it makes perfect sense.
It works perfectly, yeah.
So, guys, so I don't have to waste time later. Y'all are going to go ahead and see the map for later, but y'all aren't there yet.
Sure.
So, I'm just going to go ahead and move you guys over.
I don't know, man. I don't know if these amateur role players cannot resist metagaming.
Yeah, man. Come on. I'm having a hard enough time already. Come on.
Clearly, noobs, please kick.
Yeah. So you guys, as you get to the falls, describe first. Let me read my own note. So you guys come rushing up onto the top of the falls. You do see a small pathway that leads down around to the left. From the top of the falls, you do see, obviously, because you've been traveling with them, like the bright blue wagon of Dashiell's cart. You can make out Stroth's cart, a lot of the other carts there at the bottom of the falls. To your right, you do see that there is a pathway that leads down and around to make it down to the base of the falls. This is a direction people come. Not a huge roadway, but it is a path that has been used and is not treacherous, and certainly not for a war horse to be able to make it down to this. One of the things you do notice is Liam's caravan is not alone. There seems to be another group of folks and wagons a little bit to the north of the main pool at the bottom of the falls that seem to be camped here as well, as you come sort of charging into this Allie, as you come charging into this this scene. So Cal, Iska, what do you guys do as you come swinging around? Again, it's about a 40-foot cascade of falls. You come down around the corner. There's a small stream that that exits from the pool at the bottom of the waterfall. Right across from that stream, you can see where Liam's caravan has been camped.
Okay, I look for Stroth as I'm coming down and then crossing and going into the camp, and I want to just get Iska to Stroth.
And Iska is first. Yeah, Stroth right away.
So you guys should have control over your characters, and you should be able to see Stroth there. You see him sort of across. Do y'all see the name tags? Just because I didn't know if that worked or not.
No.
Oh, man.
I just see pictures.
Okay. This is Stroth here.
Okay. So. With Iska on my back, and I come straight over. I remain a horse for now in case we need to dash back.
Gotcha.
Yeah, as Kel is like riding in to like Iska is like shouting out Stroth's name, like hoping to see him or grab his attention or like, you know, like questioning like where he is.
So yeah, you Stroth hears you guys coming in such an uproar. What is it? What is it, Iska? Because he remembers you all talked for quite some time, so he's familiar with you.
Right. Iska says, Stroth, quick, something evil is coming. Something bad. It's something that needs to be destroyed, and we need you.
Calm down. What are you talking about first?
Something dark, something magic, something dead. We need you. We need your power. We need your divine power.
Take a breath. What has happened? Where are the rest of your party? Are they okay? Do they need healing? Are they dead?
She breathes and she says, "They're on their way. They shouldn't be too far behind us. We had to get here. Something's after me. Some things are after me. I don't know how they work. I don't know what motivates them, what drives them. But I do know that if with your help, we can kill them." And
why do you think that I'm important in this?
Luck, our blood hunter. He said that with some divine power, some holy power, we can take out these creatures, these monsters.
Are they fiends?
Yes, that's the word, fiends.
Coming here. He looks around and quickly takes stock of, just like in the storm, children, regular folks, not warriors, not people who are prepared for this, and goes, "This is indeed grave. We must prepare the caravan." So he goes over to Liam, briefs him, says, "Iska, how many? How many and how powerful?"
"Three of them, and I don't know. I don't know how powerful. Our party could barely manage three of them before, and now they rise stronger."
"They've risen."
They were dead. They've been dead. They've been dead several times, and they keep coming back."
He seems even more urgent now. He grabs Philip Bailey and Wallace Shaw, who are the two guards who who helped out with the Green Dragon flight. You're familiar with the two of them, and he brings them over to you. "We'll prepare." He sort of sends a little bit of a message out to the other caravan as well, saying to stay away from the pathway, stay away from the falls, and sort of ask them to get back, knowing that that this could get nasty.
Real quick, and apologies for forgetting his name, the merchant here who had given me some lip about Bati and the idea of a Qualverine being here. Is he around somewhere?
Aldrus, you don't see him, but I mean, you see his wagon. He might be inside, or it could be around the camps elsewhere. The glass blower? Gnome, yeah.
Right. Okay. Then just for now, I'm gonna be following Stroth's leads, sticking close to Kel, and doing anything I can to help under him and Liam prepare the caravans, whether that's getting women and children and those who can't fight away, whether that's setting up some blockades or something. I'm just listening to them and trying to prepare.
Yeah, pretty much in the confusion right now, you are unable to, you don't think that there's any way you're going to be able to make a big thing of defense other than just to try to, prepare yourself for what might be coming. Certainly some of the other caravan members, they take to the inside of their wagons. One of the things you notice as this is happening, the caravan, Liam's caravan that you've been traveling with, is very much, I don't know a better way to describe it than gypsy carts. They're hard sides, hard roofs, real doors. The other wagons very much seem to be like freight wagons, open backed. A couple of them seem to be closed, but only about half carts. It's not like you would live inside them. Maybe they're carrying something else. But pretty much in the time that this has passed, we'll say that the rest of the party, breathless, comes charging in. Luck, these things are on your tail as you all come sort of running down the pathway.
Okay, once I see the rest of the party coming down the path, I drop my horse form.
Okay.
And I become I'm gonna become something. Give me a sec.
Okay. Everyone else sort of move yourself to where you would like to be.
They're coming! Get ready! So, yeah, let's say about here. Sort of directly in the middle of the
map. Yeah, Celia has been, keeping in the back, kind of keeping watch. basically ready to pounce on them and surprise them if they try anything with the party that she's with.
I'm on 19 hit points.
Yeah, Axel's, you know, straight up looking for, you know, rise out, looks for Iska, heads right up, it's like, checks if she, you know, you okay, you good?
I'm fine, yes. Yeah, I'm fine. Yes. Stroth knows, he knows, he's gonna help.
Yeah, and sort of, you know, he's already, you know, he's, you know, battle cat right now as well, so.
And Kel becomes a direwolf.
Okay. Right about that time, you all hear a haunting, horrible howl go out from above the falls. I need all of you guys to roll initiative.
Axel's kind of shouted them to come back closer and then initiative.
I'll take 10 foot. I'll take 5 feet back.
It'll be 8, not 20.
Okay.
Yeah, because he has a plan, and he didn't tell you his plan, and now you're ruining his plan. It's fine. He got an 8. It won't make any difference.
16.
It's good. Make sure to close your eyes and really like drink in the sound of that howl.
Okay. NPCs. Oh, it's gonna be another one of these guys. Bear with me for just a second while I get everyone up and going.
I'm gonna be right back while we're setting up here.
Why okay. Do I get the feeling I'm going to roll double ones?
Oh, well, you already used your portents, so never mind.
Yeah, no, I used for both my portents, yeah.
Okay.
Can I go ahead and roll a stealth for Celia? Because she would have been stealth, like, keeping watch and stuff.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Can I roll beer groove?
Beer groove?
Beer groove?
Wow, this is a big map, too. Whoop. We're going to go over top of some stuff because this is crazy. Crazy, I say. Let me get stuff in order. So, as you guys do this...
Are those horses still there by the edge of the river?
Yeah, currently they are. People were so concerned about themselves, no one seems to have taken care of the livestock and stuff to this point.
Fair enough. Oh, crap, and I'm already a wolf. Damn.
Yeah, if you're already a wolf, if you're already a dire wolf, they're probably not going to be there for long. But let me go ahead and get this going. I'm sorry, I need to get into Stroth. Stroth, because he was prepared for this, he yells out, "Stay close. If these need to see the radiant light, this will help." And casts Crusader's Mantle.
I haven't heard of that one yet.
And let me roll that up for you so you all see what it does. So within 30 feet of Stroth, your attacks all do a d4 of radiant damage. Nice. You should see his aura, yes?
No.
Nope.
Have you made sure you click the little box that says see aura on the settings?
Oh, let me do that. Did that do it?
Nope.
Huh. I think it might be that I have to be able to show you
his character sheet.
His character sheet.
Mm. Yeah, it might be a permissions thing, yeah.
No, you can usually sort of have the...
I'm going to try and be an oversized sheepdog and see if I can circle behind these couple of horses and hopefully not get them to, like,
that
bolt.
Do it?
But get them back across and
can you see Zora now?
No.
Nope.
Darn it. Funny, because I thought since I could see it, everyone could see it. Let me try.
Oh, well, we'll keep it in mind. 30 feet. Well,
we'll keep it in mind. 30 feet.
Yeah.
Step out of it. Might run this.
Shoe horses. Shoe.
I'm going to do
this.
How are these
going to work?
Don't move him around. Did that do it?
There, yes.
Okay.
I see that.
You basically are all able to control him now, but don't.
Okay.
So, with that, up at the top of the falls, you see appear before you truly more horrific than before, bathed in bathed in this sort of purple black aura and light. You see the reborn hounds of Bati. Their spikes across their back are large, just metal blades that run down the back of their spines. Before, they sort of still seem to have some kind of flesh. Now all you see is sort of the robotic skeleton. At the shoulders, there are these big, massive plates that seem to guard their insides. The form that was once flesh is now just made out of necrotic, sort of purple energy. And you see places where their skeleton has been fused together with these metal constructs that were inside him. Their eyes glow this incredibly deep red with sort of blue lightning sparking inside of it. Their tails, before which didn't draw attention, now seem to be these long spiked chains with barbed hooks on the ends of them, and this sort of infernal fire burns within their chest. And with that, Kifa, your old buddy Iska, rolled a nat 20 on its initiative.
She was just so happy to see me.
Let's see.
Was I able to get the horses out of the way?
I would say you're in the process of it, just because of where you are in initiative. I'm going to say some of this happens first.
Okay.
Because where are you? Kel, well, you're an 18. I'll say you can move one of them. Which one of them would you like to move?
Probably this one. The one I'm next to.
The friendlier looking one.
The one you're right next to. Yeah, you basically nip at its heels, and yeah, it charges.
I don't want to do that. I don't want to charge.
It's not in a panic charging, but it it certainly got the heck out of Dodge.
Okay.
So Kifa, let me see distance wise. Kifa leaps off of the top of this, and it's interesting as you see. This dog move, you see it almost galloping on the air itself. It's not falling like gravity normally would. It is running and then hits the surface of the water and literally runs across the top of the water. It is heading straight towards Stroth, feeling the holy energy that is coming from him, and whips out with two brutal throwing its shoulders into Stroth. With a crappy roll. And a natural one.
Good!
It tries to come across there, and somehow as it comes up out of the water, it is unable to catch purchase or loses its footing a little bit and sort of slides around Stroth and doesn't fall over, but it is, he is definitely unable to connect with his first attacks. Luna, it is now your turn.
Okay. Well, that kind of changed my plans a little bit. That's okay. I am gonna. So right now, Stroth is on land, though. He's not in the water.
Nope, he is on land.
Okay. So she is going to actually. She should definitely have enough movement to get over there. Yeah, it's fine. She's going to, seeing that this is seems to be the intent, she's gonna get over right into. Is this on its square or is this?
Oh no, that's next to its square.
That's next to its square. Okay, I just wanted to make sure. She's gonna get right up in its face because a holy man's kind of important, and give it the old rope-a-dope.
Okay.
There it is.
23 definitely hits.
Okay. So. And a radiant D4. Did you say?
And a radiant D4. Yes.
Okay. First one.
Nice. So you come swinging into it, and.
Sorry.
No problem. You come swinging into it, and your bludgeoning attack, you hit it, but the armor is really seems to be really tough on these things. However, as you swing your weapon, you see it as it sweeps through the air. It becomes golden and catches this golden light on it, and as that light connects with it. It is, you see the dog visibly wince as you make a connection with this necrotic energy that is surrounding it.
Okay. And as I do the, go for a kick, boot to the head.
Yep.
No.
Unfortunately, just the sheer, as you get close to it, you see just the horror that is this animal, and it distracts you. You're unable to like put your foot close to that. Garofrost, hey, how you doing? Kel, you are up.
Okay, do I see that third one way up towards the top at the top of the falls up there? Or do I only see the two near me?
You look up towards Naffa. You are just... You heard a noise from that thing, and you are focused on trying to locate this other one. You heard it from there. From your training in the wilderness, you know that there is one hiding up there. And as you stare straight into the eyes of Naffa, out of the corner of your eye, you notice deep green lines of magic pouring through the center of this waterfall. It almost calls out, this natural magic almost calls out to the instincts of your wolf form, and a voice that almost seems like the spirit behind Luna from the last time you were in battle sort of rings in your head. Grab destiny by the reins.
Imagine wolf growling, because I can't.
Yeah.
Imagine bared wolf fangs, because I can't do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Grab your destiny. You hear it echoing through your head. The wolf, for some reason, is drawn to this as well. It's instinctual.
And where is this? Where am I perceiving this line to be?
All through the center of the Cascade of the Falls. And as you even begin to wonder where they are, you see the lines actually start to drift out towards you, pulling away from the falls, almost being drawn to you by like a magnet just from your interest in them.
Okay, then I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
As you take your third step,
Okay. 5, 4, 3.
And get in to, let me make sure I measured that right. Yep. Within about 30 feet of them, this green ley line of energy comes whipping out at you, hitting your form and wrapping its essence around you. The hide of your direwolf form seems to harden and become almost like bark as a natural armor begins to form around your direwolf form. It isn't without strain, though. I need you to roll me a d6. I need you, give me 1 second to make sure I've got this right. Where the hell did Stroth go? I just need a character sheet. Where's my damn character sheets? I need you, with your human form, to roll me a dexterity saving throw. Okay. Now I need you to roll a d4, please. Your human side, this almost the astral form of yourself that is inside of the wolf, feels almost this electric shock go through your nervous system. And your human form suffers from 1 point of dexterity attribute damage. Please, you need to lower your dexterity by 1 in your human form, but your wolf form is not affected.
Really, I guess then.
It's almost as though your nerves are numbed.
I hope this isn't permanent.
But in the meantime, you have learned a new ley line spell.
What?
If you look in your handouts, you will see you now know the ability Ley Defense, by which is the nature form of Ley Defense.
I'm presuming I have to be not in wild shape to do that.
Nope. I read it. That's what's just happened to you.
Oh.
So your AC is now 16 while in this wild shape, for as long as you were in that wild shape.
And is that any wild shape?
That's what it says.
Nice.
So yes, you are now a dire wolf with a basically bark skin armor. Its fur and hide has now become hardened like the bark of a tree.
Okay.
Welcome to your destiny, Kel.
Not to all.
Anyway, back to the combat.
Okay. So that was 15 feet of my 50 feet of movement.
Yes. It's about a 30-foot wall next to you, though.
Right. I realize that. I'm at the bottom of the falls, and it's like...
In Wills and Waffles showing up for their normal host. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Okay. Shit. All right. I kind of do a, even though I'm not wet, I kind of do a dog kind of shake.
Yep.
And then, just kind of shake my head a bit. And then, it's 1, 2, well, let's say 3, 4, 5, 6, Is this shallows?
Yep, that's shallow. Like, you can go right across.
7, 8, 9, and I am going to bite this sucker.
Go for it.
And because I have pack tactics, I get advantage.
Yep, you sure do. Waffle raid! Woo!
Good old tactics.
Thanks, Waffles. Unfortunately, as you getting used to this new bark skin. Hey, all the wafflers! Thank you guys so much. We appreciate it. I'm sorry, I forgot you had advantage. Yep, no, 15. You know what? Still doesn't hit it. You just glance off of its off of these hard metal plates that are guarding it.
Okay, so I just kind of recover my balance, probably because of skirting the water and running around Luna. That caused me to miss, and then I just position myself and just growl at awesome. The thing. And I guess that's my turn.
Okay, Wallace Shaw is up next. He is right next to this thing. He is going to take a big old swing at it with his spear. And actually gets two. Oh, he gets three. Good lord, I forgot that he's a badass. A 14, he unfortunately misses. 26, he does hit for 11 piercing plus a d4 damage. For plus 2 radiant. So he swings around again, just the terrifying presence of this at first sort of makes him miss, but then he realizes he has an opening. He sticks his spear down through a gap in the plates and does a good number of damage on it. And again, the golden light as he shoves his spear in, the tip sort of begins to glow with this golden radiant light, and really you hear the dog almost whimper as this goes sinking, the radiant damage goes sinking into it. He pulls his spear back out to take a final last attack at it with his incredible speed. He does make that attack for another 11 piercing damage plus the radiant damage as well. And as the spear again was lodging deeper inside of it, the Kifa starts to writhe back and forth, but she is pissed off now. Luck, it is your turn.
It is Luck's Goldheart's turn, and boy, there we go. Luck Goldheart has returned. And he is charging up this hill. And so he's running straight forward up here, and he is going to make a leap. As he does so, he's going to try and shoot his hand crossbow just before he leaps.
Okay.
Oh, no, that's 10 because I didn't have advantage.
Yeah. Unfortunately, as you leap, you are unable to make a good shot off onto Raynar, and it sees it coming, is able to dodge out of the way. Where do you plan on landing? Do me an acrobatics for me. Or okay. Athletics, either one, since it's just a jump down. Your choice.
Yeah.
Yep, you land, no problem.
Yep, so I saw the... It's can I jump 10 feet from
here? Oh, yeah, because it's up in the air. At that point, it's sort of sloping down. It's only probably about 10 feet in the air, so yeah.
So I jump 10 feet, land in the water, and sort of... Can I bonus action swap out to my pick?
Yep, sure can.
And I
actually that doesn't even take a bonus action, but yeah, you're able to do that.
Yeah, just so it's still way that so just hand crossbow back onto the belt. Hand crossbow throws up into his right hand and takes a step back, and he sort of taunts it like may have missed you with the bolt, but won't miss you with this. Bring it.
Cool. Iska, you are up.
Cool. So, just a mechanic question. If I want to attack this hound right here,
yep.
Do I need to like find a better line of sight because it's kind of blocked on all sides by my party, or can I still attack it?
Here's the thing. If you miss, you could have on that line of sight, you could have a possibility of hitting someone in your party.
Then I'll just move to a better place, I think. So I'll go 1, 2. I'll pop off.
Keep in mind their range, okay.
Yeah.
And as soon as she rushes over here, she will utter the word Skaggeth.
Cool.
As she takes the tongue of the hound that Kel had bitten off last time, and as she says Skaggeth, the tongue kind of like straightens out and becomes a little bit rigid, and she is going to swing it at this hound like a whip.
Yep.
For a 22 to hit.
22 definitely hits.
And that does 1 slashing, 6 fire, and 2 radiant damage.
Cool. So it's interesting. You sling out with this tongue, and as you connect with it, it seems to pass through all of this hound's defenses, as it was a part of it at one time. And the damage that it does seems to be almost maximized for the worst possible way, because this is not anything that it is. It's basically attuned to it as well, and does not trigger any of its normal defenses of its armor class. Let's see. Kifa whips around though and sees Iska as she is attacked by. It is now Nafa's turn. Let's see. I need to do. Nafa jumps off of here, and again comes almost galloping through the air and across the water. And let's see, what is my range? It comes up to about right there, and seeing everyone harrying Kifa, because it has not been attacked this time, you see, as it's standing there, its plates seem to reconfigure themselves sort of around this its chest, where all of this heat, this sort of infernal fire, seem to be burning from inside of its rib cage. And it seems to almost, they close in, and almost as though instead of being armor anymore, they are focusing this infernal heat inside of it. You see its tail lift up behind it and crack out like a whip towards Wallace Shaw. And with a 19, it's going to hit. The tail just with a horrible sickening ka-thunk pierces right through his armor, right into his gut. And then you see what that reconfiguration of that armor was all about. You see blazing white heat go burning down the chain and right into Wallace Shaw's chest. It is so bright within his chest, you can see his rib cage and his organs as though it was on an x-ray, because the light inside of him is so bright. As Nafa is able to configure herself into her emoliate attack. Let's see. Minus 37. Wallace just screams out in pain as then the hook comes ripping back out of him, taking a chunk of burned flesh with it and reels itself back in to Naffa's hide. With that, it is Raynar's turn. Raynar comes leaping down, sees the taunting by Luck, and comes up right beside Luck, ready to attack. It first does a tries to slam into it with his shoulder for an 11.
Nope.
And then opens its mouth with these horrifying teeth that don't even look like teeth anymore. They almost look like curved daggers to come biting down on you with a natural one. Come on!
Yeah!
I make these really nasty things and...
Ooh, good.
So yeah, it... for some reason, it doesn't seem to be able to connect with you. It's almost as though something is holding it back as it's trying to attack. Hidden by Axel. Wow, 37 viewers. I think that's my new record, guys. Hey, thank you all of the wafflers for showing up and sticking around for the show. We are on to Hidden by Axel.
Right. So, Hidden by Axel. It's a little overwhelmed, to be honest. He goes to, like, cast a spell, and then he sort of pauses as he sort of sees it come down, like, flying, and then, like, the whole shroud of necromantic energy, and it's like, you know, he's a little lost, and then he sort of takes a moment to think, and he will scramble up into the tree to one of the lower branches using his claws, climbing speed of 20. So he now has sort of a height, so he can look out and throw and attack things from above the group, if that's possible.
You have the high ground.
Yep, I'll give you high ground.
I have the high ground. He is, however, not going to cast a spell. What he is going to do, however, is he is going to draw a dart and throw it at the immolate.
The one that was doing the emoliation?
Yes, that one.
Naffa,
yes. Pretty Naff. Anyway. So that is a 14. It's not a hit.
Nope, it is not. Okay, is that your turn? Anything else you'd like to do? Donovan, thanks for following.
There is.
And someone else too. I missed the other one. Anything else you want to do or can do?
No, nothing else he can do, yeah.
Huh. Anyway, so next up we have Celia. Being all sneaky, right. You are well and truly hidden.
But I want to get inside the radiant. So I'll come up here.
Do a lunge and attack?
Oh no.
20 will hit.
Oh.
And for 11 piercing and 1 radiant.
And
you have sneak attack as well.
And sneak attack.
And wow.
It's
an unlikely alliance.
22.
That's here right now. I'm gonna say.
So you stick into Raynar, this dog, and again, because of your piercing attack, you're able to sort of fit through all of these armor plates and metal ribs that are part of it, and get deep down inside of it, and. Once again, the weapon begins to glow with radiant energy, which seems to hurt more than even the piercing damage that you had done before. It is now Philip Bailey's attack. Philip, our Deadeye sharpshooter, he's going to take one step to the left and just unleash on Naffa, who just emoliated his buddy. With 3 rapid-fire longbow attacks. 17 will hit. I'm just going to go ahead and roll all these. So 17 hits. 17 hits. And a 13 misses. So the first two go flying in for 19 piercing, 16 piercing, and 2. Wow. So that's, let's see, maths. 10 plus, that was 25, plus 10 for 35 damage on Naffa. Okay, why can I not get her little dots to show up? I'm going to have to keep track of this manually. So, what did I say? 35?
35.
So again, the piercing damage seems to be able to pass through these dogs' defensives into sort of this this almost spectral form that is inside of them, and do them more damage than you've seen some of the other forms of attack seem to not be able to penetrate down into the depths of this. Hey, Skagath, your item is being used. Just letting you know. With that, it is Stroth's turn, and he is done with this shit. He picks up his maul, and feeling the fiendish energy and the undead energy from inside of these, turns his weapon. He says a short prayer to Helm, and his weapon, this giant maul, two-handed maul that he has, begins to glow like sunrise, as holy light, white light, infuses it. And he is going to take a swing with his sacred vicious maul for a 20 for the first attack. And he is going to make that a improved divine smite. He does 15 bludgeoning. He's going to do Divine Smite at level 4 for 24 radiant damage. 24, so 48 radiant damage. And then plus another. Unfortunately, the bludgeoning does not seem to be as effective. It goes slamming into the plates, but is not able to penetrate the way that the piercing damage was able to. But the radiant that hit this dog, just, you see its whole form, this spectral form, almost shake and shudder from within. In fact, parts of it almost seem to break off and just with screams disappear into the shadows, but it's able to coalesce again, and you see this little fiery heart inside of it still pulses just once or twice. And goes out.
No reflex save?
Hmm?
No reflex save? No detonate?
No detonate.
Good!
A different form than they had before.
Oh, maybe.
The mechanical form seems to be laying there inert for the time being.
I was waiting for that red X to appear before I celebrated. All right, it's confirmed now.
It's confirmed.
Confirmed.
Something horrible is going to happen, I just know it.
Well, Kifa, there were red X's the last time, so.
Kifa seems to...
give me a moment, okay?
Kifa seems to be inert at the time for the time being. Luna, it is your turn.
Okay, question. Do these things count as creatures?
Yes. Well, for what?
Well, because
they are not organic creatures. If it's a creature that, you know, if it's the direwolf slam attack to see if it gets knocked over, yes. If it is because it's because it's alive or something like that, then no. So,
because one thing, because I'm trying to figure, because what she would try to do is, because these things have come into the water, which if she can do what she wants to is a bad idea for them. And so she'd try to like use her shape cantrip, you know, like, cause these are both, yeah, the one by Cillian Luck is definitely in the water. Yeah, that's they both are. So basically form like a cube around these and then freeze it.
You can certainly try.
Okay. Snake, because that's what she do. I mean, they're perfectly positioned to try and do that, and the one in front of me is dead, so I wouldn't.
Yep.
It's a great DM answer.
I've grown to hate that phrase.
Yeah.
I mean,
figure at least maybe have them waste an action or something. So yeah, so she try and do that with this one right here.
Okay.
So just water around and then freeze.
Okay. I'm going to say he gets a con save. That seems fair, yeah?
Sure, yeah.
A con save to see whether he gets frozen. With a natural 20.
Of course.
With a natural 20, the block of ice comes up around it and encases it. And especially since this one just did the emoliate attack, basically you just see the heat from inside of it build again. And the water melts and falls back down into the lake.
Fair. I just need to make sure. Okay, so that's my action. Melvin, I'm going to actually, Luna's gonna go, never use my action. Where's she gonna go? I guess she'll close with it then.
Okay.
Get right up next to it. And that'll be your turn.
Kel, it is your turn.
All right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And a bite.
Yep.
With advantage.
Yep.
Tactics.
16 definitely hits.
So that is plus the radiant 1d4, right?
Yep.
Hey.
You bite into it, you get a hold of its leg and give it a good shake, and again, your teeth sort of glow, and you see that radiant light is what is doing the most amount of damage to it as you as attack it.
But it does now need to make a DC 13 strength saving throw.
DC 13 strength saving throw. With a 10, it is prone. Correct? Knocked prone?
Yep, it is knocked prone.
Gotcha. Remind me of that when we come around. I don't think he's moving anywhere, but... that gives people advantage on melee attacks, right?
I believe it does.
If someone wants to look that up, that'd be great. Wallace Shaw is going
Which condition was it?
Prone.
Advantage on melee attacks, yeah. Advantage on melee attacks, disadvantage on range attacks. I know those off the top of my head.
The creature has disadvantage on attack rolls, and an attack roll against the creature, a melee attack roll, has advantage.
Gotcha.
Range attacks are a disadvantage.
Yep.
Okay. Wallace, with his spear, because he has... he has reach on it, is going to attack this one twice out in the water for a 13, which misses, and a 19, which does hit, for 9 piercing plus his radiant. 2 for 13 damage onto Kifa, which, again, for some reason, my dots aren't coming up. What did I say it was? 13, something like that?
Yes.
Yep. Cool. And that is his turn. Luck, you are up. You are muted.
Good old me. Okay. Look, Goldheart has got this. As Silly is attacking one side, I attack the other. So war pick comes round, hopefully. Yep, because it's prone, right? So it's
yep, planted. 16.
Beautiful. So that's 6. Minimum damage. Sad face. And so 8 damage.
Okay. Get 8 damage on the prone dog, getting a fairly good not a good connection with your pick, but again, the golden light goes streaming down into it and definitely is hurting it more than anything. Iska, Tull, you are up.
All right. Crack that whip back. Turn to face this hound right here that's in between Luna and... Was that Wallace?
Yep, it's Wallace.
And I swipe that whip at that one for a 19.
19 will hit.
For one slashing, for three fire, and for one radiant damage.
Mighty one.
We're number one.
Again, with this whip, because it has been a part of it, you are finding that it is seems to be doing far more damage than you would expect for it to be able to do. It cuts right through its defenses and does a huge amount of damage, even though slashing doesn't seem to have worked for other people. It does seem to be working with this specific weapon. With that, it is Naffa's turn, which is that one. I need luck to make a perception check.
Okay. I'm going to spend some inspiration on that.
Okay.
So, 1d12.
Ooh, 19 for 19.
Thank you, chat.
This dog looks straight up at you, looks you in the eye, looks almost scared for a moment, maybe surprised, does a slight bow to you, and then turns to attack Celia instead.
It knows fear.
It's going to make a necrotic slam against Celia for a 10, and then a bite for a 22.
That'll do it.
It's something
For 16 piercing damage. And you need to make a DC 14 saving strength saving throw or be knocked prone. You are knocked prone.
Okay.
And stand by. It's part of its action. It's going to do it. So as a bonus action, you are on the ground. Any creature that is on the ground next to it, it's going to perform a gut rip. Oh, shit.
The natural 20.
You take 29 points of slashing damage as it...
I am down.
Rips into your midsection.
Yeah. I am all the way down, guys.
Is there a movement component to that attack or anything?
As a bonus action, it's literally, as a bonus action, tears into any adjacent prone creature, inflicting 3d12 slashing damage.
You're not dead, you're down. Don't put the skull.
Oh, actually, the target must succeed on a DC 14 constitution saving throw or be incapacitated for 1d4 rounds. Actually, you're already incapacitated, so never mind. So, yeah.
We were making fun of their nat ones and shitty rolls earlier, but good lord.
It's come back. It's come back.
It is now Raynar's. That was Raynar. Oh, did I do them out of order? I did, didn't I?
Yeah, you did.
Okay, so...
Does that negate the attack, then? Is that what happened?
They're back and forth. I mean, so. With that, this one that's next to Luna disappears.
What the f?
Reappears over here, not provoking an attack of opportunity.
Oh, that's just cheap.
And
good course.
Now that it is out of. Now that it is out of. Range, you see its plates pull in. It tries to throw in a pale attack at Wallace. And he misses and goes landing right into this horse. Because the horse is there. The tail just goes ripping right into it. The emoliate goes through it. You literally see this giant draft horse just disintegrate into...
That was the one I tried to get out of the way.
Disintegrate into dust.
Look how sad.
No good deed goes unpunished.
I mean, Silly going down. Oh no, the horse dying.
Oh, we'll deal with Silly going down in this minute. Yeah, don't you worry.
Axel, it's your turn.
All right. Axel's sort of looking between Cilia is down on the ground. This creature is out of reach of everyone else. He's like, I don't know what to do. And then, like, sort of moment of brilliance, it's like, of course I can do this. He will throw a dagger, into the air, say the incantation, and he will cast magic missile at second level, two bolts at each of them because he can.
Okay.
So
that will be six to each plus. Do me 4d4.
It doesn't count as a weapon attack, though, so it's not affected by the spell.
True.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep, so six to each of them. Is that how that works? It's not 12 each, right?
So that's a,
Something's wrong here.
Wait, it's normally three. And you add
It would normally be 12, and then you get the three from the last one. So
okay, gotcha. So it's 15.
15, yeah.
So seven each.
Yeah, or seven to one, eight to the other.
So we'll put, yeah.
Just pick one, yeah. He will then drop down and head over to try and pretty much pull Celia back.
Okay.
That's his whole movement, but he can't even get there. Really. He can get about to there, and that's all he can do. So, yeah.
Celia, I need you to make a death saving throw.
Don't roll a one.
Oh goodness!
You fail your first death save.
Lisa don't like that.
Philip Bailey is seeing the danger over here. Is going to use his three. Longbow attacks onto the one next to Celia. For 14, misses. 16 hits, and a 10 misses badly. On the one that he does hit on, does 13 points of piercing damage, plus another 6 points of radiant. With that, it is Stroth's turn. Seeing what's going on, he comes. Let's see. Let's get some distance. 15. Yep, so he's going to come running by. That's right, he's at this level. Drops a lay on hands onto, or actually drops as a bonus action a healing word onto Celia to get her up.
Ooh!
Healing word at first.
Oh, hell, Saint Stroth.
Actually, let's go ahead and get you up. He's got extras of these, doesn't he? No, he's going to do it as a level 3. Level 3 healing word, which gives you 13 hit points. Continue his movement around and do his two attacks with his maul. Twenty-one will hit for 11 bludgeoning plus improved vine smite at level 4. I don't even need to do the math. He just comes slamming in there and completely crushes this dog underneath of his maul as the radiant light goes pouring down into it. Since he's not using his second attack, he then, you see him, after knocking it unconscious, takes a moment and takes a vial of holy water out of his belt and pours it on it. And you see this one, this black spirit, whoosh, the wisping up out of it, and you see the body itself completely disintegrate until it's gone. Its whole
good show.
Being went away. And next, Kifa needs to roll.
Maybe. Kifa just.
You see Kifa start to twitch a little bit, but doesn't seem to quite be up and moving. Luna, it's your turn.
Okay, I imagine it hearing, so even knowing that it's resolved now, hearing Celia's like have a cry out, just like, like that.
a very stealthy death scream.
Exactly. Luna, like whip we'll around and look in that direction. See it's basically resolved. Still be really mad. See this thing start to twitch and just crack down on it again. So I'll close with it and do that.
Okay. You crack down on it, and you see the radiant light damage go into it, and you see this one dissolve as well. You still have... Hey, bestie! Helping hand. Which helping hand? Let me know. Send me a DM or put it in chat of what you want to use that for.
Right or left?
You still have movement and you still have your unarmed.
Okay. So I want to go... So actually, yeah, that was only 5 feet of it.
Yeah, you've got
so...
plenty of movement left.
So okay, so I think I just want to make sure I can actually get to the other one before I do it. Yep, I can.
Yep.
So I got 40. Boom! And then I just kind of... I imagine at least for the... Just thematically, can I say I kind of like do the Iceman and I slide over there?
Absolutely.
Awesome. Whee! Like, and then like as the kick's going off, go for like, you know, just like a, again, like an axe kick off of it. See if it actually hits. If I open the right sheet. Nope.
Unfortunately, slid a little too far. Nope, you slid a little bit too hard. You kind of we'll say you came up short. No. It's like you just misjudged it by just a hair, and you swing out with your foot and just missed it by that much. Kel, it's your turn.
One and a two and a three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. As fast. That's my max movement.
Okay.
So okay, I couldn't get there. So that's, I guess, all I can do.
Wallace is going to come up and start. Actually, he's going to come up on this side and do his try spear attacks.
You know, can I toss in, if that's all I can do, I'm just going to use my action to do a little bit of a dash and at least get it right.
Yep, you're welcome to. Wallace, sick of these things too. With a 20, 15, and an 8, so he only hits once. For 9 piercing plus his d4. So six,
he's
15.
Not in the aura, is he? The aura. Then you have to be in the
aura.
Oh,
you're right. He's not in the aura. You're absolutely right. Nope, you are right. So he only does 9 piercing to it.
Sorry, guys. That was the person who pointed
out. Oh, no, you're right.
No, that's fine.
Thanks for keeping me honest. Yep.
Yep.
Luck,
yeah,
you
I'm
are up.
That's the right thing to do.
Yep. So, look, Goldharter has decided that we took two down. There's that third one, but I will not be in the lovely light that is so needed to take this down. So I will stall it by spending my my action to dash towards it. So picking up,
okay.
And I sort of come here. And can I use my bonus action just to sort of shout at it or taunt it?
Oh, absolutely.
Can I make that intimidation or something?
Sure. You can try.
Try and intimidate it.
I'll certainly try.
I am Luke Goldheart, but prepare to be smited by justice. Oh, six. That's a six. Yeah, no. It's hard to scare a demon, though. Who would have thought?
Yeah. I am Luke Goldheart, prepare to be the
Yeah.
Hey, hey, hello.
Iska, it is your turn.
Great for me.
Sorry, I was recovering from a tiny luck voice.
yeah, tiny luck.
Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, I think I can boogie over here. Even without the radiant damage, I've noticed that whip is tearing into these fools. Yep. So I'm rushing up. And I'm just trying to slash that whip around this hound. And with a 10, yikes.
Unfortunately, you do not. You unlike before where you've been able to connect with this, maybe it's because there's so many people around, you're just unable to get this the whip to connect.
Because I'm actually like super rattled that someone got immolated because of me. Like, that sucks. And so now I'm taking like extra precautions not to make sure no one else gets hurt. I don't want anyone like caught in the crossfire of this whip.
Let's see. God, no one's hit him. No, I guess Wallace. Did Wallace? Wallace did connect. So yeah, he will retaliate back against Wallace with his necrotic slam. Tries to throw a shoulder. Misses, damn it. With a bite, 22 hits though. For 9 piercing damage on Wallace, and Wallace needs to make a strength saving throw, or else gets knocked. He makes his strength thing, so he is still up, which is good, because being prone is bad around these. Axel, you are up. Again, with the muted.
I'm going to do this every single time I realize that I'm muted. And then just make up shit. Okay, so Axel is going to, you know, head over to check on Celia. He's sort of, you know, you see this little cat, like, poke his head over. And then, you know, sort of, you know, he's checking, like, he, you know, boundaries. No, he doesn't have them. So, you're checking over to see if the wound is right. Okay. And then you'll sort of glance over at this combat there and, almost as if he was like, you know, distracted, he'll sort of, you know, pull out one of his daggers, throw it up in the air, say an incantation, and that's his last magic missile of the day at the last 5 and 1. That's a 14 force damage on the dude.
Gosh, I gotta rearrange my map so they can see all of you guys. Y'all are like all up on the other side of the map.
And he's sort of like, are you okay? Are you okay? You're not hurt? You can stand? You're all right? You're all right? He's like, are you awake? Hey.
So yeah, no, with that 14 yeah. force damage into the dog.
The dog?
Oh, gosh. Check.
You're the man now, dog.
I gotta do math, sorry. 20. Hey, Axel, how do you want to do this?
He's not even looking as the three little bolts of blue white light sort of flash up into the air, arc over, and it's like an artillery strike. They just go boom, 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 and it sort of pieces break off each hit as it's like, because it's quite a good roll as well.
Yeah.
So it's just sort of like these three like strikes from the sky, like sparking stars from the sky, strike down, leave like craters in the body and the earth as it sort of
these go slamming down into it. It is inert. It does not seem, however, the body is still remains there. Celia.
I am muted. Okay. All right. I really don't have anything that can help it. Because Axel brought it down.
So, yes, it is down, but not disintegrated.
Out. Basically.
Yep.
So, Celia will use half her movement to stand up. You can't do anything for it. Hit it again, make sure it's definitely dead.
Yeah, I don't think you
can. Hey, that worked!
Overly enthusiastic.
You have to be in the aura.
Yeah.
And you're in the water at the moment, too.
Yeah. So.
I don't see the problem with that part.
At it, you're just going to get yourself moved?
Yeah, I'll just. I can get next to it.
Okay.
With triple movement.
Philip, knowing that, seeing that it's down, but also knowing how this has worked, seems to be pretty good. He's just gonna hang there, make sure nothing else is coming. Stroth yells out, because you're right behind him in the thing, "Water girl, catch!" and throws vial of holy water into the air. It only can reach about 30 feet, but your shape water reaches about 30 feet from where you are. And so it goes arcing up through the air. You see this vial of silver, golden, radiant water in a glass vial arcing through the air towards you.
Okay, I'm going to catch it with the shape water. So he threw it 30 feet, and that's...
And you're able to reach 30 feet.
Okay.
With your shape water. I've checked this.
Okay, just wanted to make sure.
Yeah.
All right. I imagine what she would actually do is she would actually... Man, this is kind of the finishing blow thing. So, like, thematically, like, kind of break the water out of the glass.
Okay.
And then, you know, form it around her hand and then punch straight into the chest of this thing.
And you do. It's almost like punching into Jell-O. You see the steel armor, but the radiant energy allows your hand to pass through. And as you reach down in there, you can sort of feel this almost beating infernal energy deep in its chest. And you just grab on to what is its truly cursed, undead, demonic, mechanical heart, and just squeeze until it breaks. And then the whole thing just dissolves around your hand like it was never there.
Hands off my sisters.
And with that, the Hounds of Bati appear to be no more. Good job, guys.
Victory! I was muted the first time!
I thought you were saying something like that.
I'm muted. I had to redo it. I timed it so well as well. So I'm really disappointed with myself.
Combat comes to an end. There's sort of a sigh of relief. And all of a sudden... Whack. Luna, you feel something hit you in the back of your head. And as you reach around, it's like a clod of dirt.
Ow.
And you look around and you see a young girl, probably around 12 or 13, and she yells out, "The stained water girl brought the demons down on us. She's a bad person." and you hear the people from the other caravan seem to start to murmur, and you hear people asking, why did they bring that thing here? Did you see it was in our water? It's tainted the water. How are we going to make it to Morgan's Creek? Liam, are these your friends? You've doomed all of us.
I've got this.
So, wait.
Oh, I'm not.
I start to growl at the girl.
From out of the shadows, you see a lean figure appear. He has silver and gray cassock. It has white piping along all of the edges. He's human, probably around mid-30s. He has a lean, sort of angular face. His hair's oiled and slicked back. Luna, Celia, you immediately recognize what this is. He is a deacon of the Temple of Purity. Before anyone can react, I need everyone to make a charisma saving throw with disadvantage, please.
Yeah, he's a nice bloke. Damn you, looking liking literally everyone in existence.
This is probably fine.
I'm going to spend a bardic inspiration on that. It's a d12, I think.
Can I do the same thing?
Actually, I'm not going to allow y'all to spend donations on this. DM's prerogative on this one. You guys are exhausted. That's mainly the reason.
Yeah,
you all woke up at the crack of dawn, fought these dogs once, went through the whole temple, made it out of the temple, and hoofed it across the Dragon Ghost Plains. It's, at this point, probably almost 9, 10 o'clock at night, and it's almost like your tongue is being held. It's not charmed, really. It's probably closer to a curse. Not doing harm, but just sort of leaving you almost dumbstruck by the presence of this person.
I still growl.
Ah, he says, from the mouths of babes. He sort of smooths down the young girl's hair as he passes by to approach the party, keeping a good distance though. You see his eyes flash golden for a second, and a slight smile cracks off of his lips. You notice that the camp, after this bow, is quickly separated back into the wagoneers, sort of crowded behind this deacon, and Liam's group sort of behind the party. Yes, sometimes the children will speak the unpleasant truths that no one likes to hear. The stained ones, you see, like this one here, forever bringing misfortune and evil in their wake. It's not their fault, really. It's the stain itself that attracts these things. They carry the burden of the sin that was committed by the fallen ones, the tieflings. That immeasurable sin that plunged our world into the shadow time that we are now muddling our way through. You see, it's the stain that she carries that does these things. She can't know the doom that she is attracted to herself and to all of those around her. But no, wait. We mustn't see the stain she carries on her soul as only a bane, though. For the stain is also a blessing in a way. You see, this stain also allows the good people and clergy of the Temple of Purity to find those like her and cleanse her of this burden. Dear child, let us help you.
I move. And
you
put can't. Myself.
You are locked in place from your losing your charisma throw.
Yeah.
Dear child, let us help you. Why bring this devastation upon your friends and all those who have offered you such hospitality? I can tell by your age that you must have been hidden during the Great Purge. And that's wonderful news, for our purification shrines of today are not plagued by the superstitions of the past. Let us relieve you of this burden. Just look around and see the corruption that has followed your every step. Why, Liam, you said yourself that within the last week after your guests had arrived that you experienced first a bandit attack, and then a storm like one you hadn't seen in over a decade. And now here, in the very sanctuary of the Verdant Falls, undead demons attack not only you, but all of us. From over in the Wagoneers, you hear a voice call out, "Put her in the box with the other!" And he gets choked off. The deacon raises his hand like this and makes a motion. All this time, he's been pacing, watching the reactions of Liam's followers. And even though you really can't move out of the corners of your eyes, you're seeing more people than you would have thought nodding in agreement. And the final act, the most devastating of all, a fallen one here in your very midst. And he waves his hand, and you see as an illusion crumbles around a human male and a young half-orc girl that you knew as Ella, revealing dark crimson skin, black horns, and glowing white eyes. You see an adult tiefling male and a young tiefling girl clutching each other in fear. The little girl, "Daddy, Daddy, I can see you!" Ella looks, runs over to her father. "Daddy, they can see us! Daddy, I'm scared!" "Don't be fooled, my parishioner. The young-looking one is no girl. She is most likely a demon imp familiar here to steal your souls. This soulless creature must be stopped before he calls more of his demons upon us. Burn the tiefling and his imp, but save the stained one for me." You hear the Wagoneers erupt into a frenzy as weapons seem to pop out from all over them, now looking more like mercenaries than wagon drivers. As this happens, you see a smoky black aura come up around the tiefling. Frosty armor appears on him, and a nasty-looking black glowing sword comes in his hand. "My daughter is no demon, and you will not harm her.
Don't do it.
My pack is with no imp. Is with my sword, and you shall taste its fury. I need all of you to roll initiative."
Can I pick an arcana to sort of what I know about, like, you know what a demon and imp and things are, as sort of understanding that, yeah, she's not an imp, or, you know, disbelieving this guy effectively? And
no. No.
Not on the tracker again.
Pure anger right now.
I stayed muted that whole. I'm so fucking angry.
I had to scream.
I'm so. I had to scream.
Axel's just like, he's not sure. Yeah, I mean, he really doesn't like this guy, but he's not sure because he doesn't know.
Oh, I lost it. I've actually goddamn lost it with this guy. But I wouldn't attack. I won't attack people because I'm a good man.
Just as this combat begins, everything looks hopeless. You see 15 Wagoneers, some of the caravanners turning towards all these. You hear a voice boom out. "All of you, calm down. Go back to your evening routine like none of this happened." And you see Stroth with a scroll in his hands flash as it burns away, a golden light boom, goes across the entire camp, and you see almost a weird torpor go over everyone's eyes, and suddenly it becomes quite calm, yourself included. He walks over to the tiefling, and you can hear him say, "Meet us at the safe house south of Sojourns on the road to Highmount. Go cross country and stay out of sight," and hands them a scroll. "Use this only if needed. It won't last long, but it might get you out of a scrape. Now go, before the stupor wears off and they get riled up again. He comes then over to the party, looking at each of you. I will release you from the deacon's influence and the scrolls, but you must remain calm. In about 5 minutes, the stupor the scroll induces will wear off and everyone will go about their night just like it's another normal evening. In 10 hours, if uninterrupted, the scroll's effect will be permanent and no one will remember this night as anything other than normal. But listen to me. Any harm or damage to anyone influenced by the spell will break it for everyone, and they will all go into a frenzy from the knowledge they have been manipulated. Also, too much emotion or agitation will break the spell as well, so walk carefully. I am the member of a sect within the Paladins of the Helm that are helping tieflings and children of the Loss get to safe places away from the Temple of Purity. Luckily, their most heinous actions are now considered illegal, but out on the road and in rural areas, bonfires still burn tieflings and lost children are taken by the deacons to the purification temples against their will. I suspected when I first saw them, but now it is confirmed by their own follower. These wagoners are transporting a lost child somewhere within their wagons against that child's will. Please, save them and make a run for Sojourn's Crossing. Agatha at the Cloak and Fireball will tell you what to do when you get and how to get them to someplace safe, but keep them hidden. If you must steal a wagon, I can cover for its missing with another scroll, but be quick, be subtle, and be careful. And whatever you do, don't break the spell or we will all be doomed. Also, take this. And he actually hands Luck a medallion. It looks like a helm. Meta, like a Spartan helm, on a silver plate. When you're in the presence of another member of my sect, the Unseen Shield, you will notice a slight shimmer where the eyes would be. It will look just like an odd reflection of light to most, but you will know it when you see it. Now go, and may Helm's protection go with you. So, I want everyone to forget the map. I want everyone to step back with me into Theater of the Mind. The rest of this is for you. If you so choose to, try to save somewhere in this caravan with the wagoneers a child of the Lost who supposedly is being transported against their will.
There's not a goddamn chance we won't do that.
I'm a wolf. I smell, I listen, I sniff, I go, or I go.
Hold on, just give me a second.
Well,
we are all fired up.
We're gonna do some.
We've got things.
Take it down.
We all want to do things here.
Yeah, emotions. Back,
I think.
The only rules for this is that you complete this rescue by the end of the session. So we've got a good hour and 45 minutes, a little bit more if we want to go extra 2 hours. As I was describing, basically you've got 5 minutes as sort of people reset to their nightly activities. Luckily the bodies of the wolves are no longer around, and you have a rescue and sneaky sneak. But remember, you need to be very careful. So let me just reset the stage, get us out of combat mode, because I know it's easy to get trapped in that. You are standing next to a large pool that is behind you, with the cascade of the Verdant Falls coming down into it. It's about a 40-foot cascade. It does make some noise. So it's not completely quiet. Full moon is overhead. There is fairly good light, but there also is fairly good light. To the north, you have a group of the wagoneers wagons seem to be in two separate small groups around two different small bonfires. To the south, you have Liam's caravan, which you all are very familiar with, that has all of, you know, the things that you've experienced with them over the last couple of days. That's the sad part. This is only day 7 of our journey, guys. Couple of days. And you have all of those things with that you're familiar with over there. As I said, surprisingly, there were a few... Oops, that's kind of loud. There were a few people who were nodding, so not everyone in Liam's caravan is necessarily going to be helpful. But you are now free to plan and decide how you want to accomplish this, knowing somewhat of what you're up against on the other side. I leave it to you, my friends.
Okay.
Okay.
All okay.
Did I do okay? Do you hate him?
Axel
sort of. Yeah. He's sort of.
Need to ask that question?
I think Axel doesn't necessarily hate him because he doesn't know this. All he really knows is that this guy is going against Luna and then going against the kid and the other guy who he doesn't know. So.
Yes. Celia has a past. She absolutely despises this.
I don't like him.
In my current mindset, he's threatening my pack.
Yeah.
Celia know from her past, like, about what kind of wagons that they usually lock the Children of the Lost in order to carry them away?
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry?
Would Celia know from her past, basically, having a kind of experience with this, would she know what the wagon looked like that they carry the Children of the Lost in?
You know that it is illegal for that some Children of the Lost volunteer to go to these shrines of purification, but for the most part, you do know that it is, while back in the olden days, they were transported by force fairly openly and publicly in like open cages, that it is now highly illegal to do so, and getting caught doing so is pretty much a death sentence for any of the clergy who might get caught doing it. So you do, that's pretty much as far as you know. They aren't going to be transporting them openly or in any way that was used in the past.
All right. I am going to relay that to everybody.
Can I turn to Luna real quick and say, Luna, you never need to be ashamed. But for now, can I attempt something? Can we try to conceal that you are Genasi so these people don't get riled up again?
Are you able to do that?
I can, if you trust me.
That's fine. I want you all to remember, stay calm. Do not let your emotions rule you. Do not hate. We will rescue this person, and that is all that matters. Let everything else float away.
Okay, if you make the DM cry, you get 100 XP. I'm
just saying. That was some Bruce Lee talking.
Iska nods at all of that, takes it in, and she takes her violin, and she begins to play a song.
Stop for a second. Go ahead. I'm just getting it ready.
Oh, he's getting the music on.
Ooh, he's getting the song ready.
Okay.
She plays one of the songs that she played for Liam's caravan a couple days ago, and she begins to play what is known as Talia's Ballad. And as she begins to play that, some magical energy begins to come forth from the music as it wraps around Luna. And Luna's green, water-like Genasi form begins to shift. And it shifts into that of an older woman, a middle-aged woman with light brown skin and some wrinkles underneath her eyes, frayed brown hair with a few graying strands in it. And as Iska continues the song, this form becomes more and more clear and more real. And soon enough, Luna is completely concealed and now appears as this middle-aged woman.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Yes, so you now see before you where Luna was standing, a woman of middle age, of little graying hair, and can I get everyone to make a perception check other than Iska? And Luna, actually.
Sure.
I am look gold heart. I roll at nines. I roll
Celia, you immediately recognize the family resemblance to Iska. This is obviously someone that she's known very well and was probably very close to in life. Kel as well.
Mm-hmm. It feels. All right, let's
do this. Okay, let's do this. Let's get serious, mode.
Okay, it looks like I have taking Luna's words to heart and knowing that my current form is influencing what I'm doing. I'm going to look at Luna and just kind of drop my head and then drop my wolf form.
Okay.
And then I want to stealth.
Ooh. Okay. So, I mean, currently you guys are sort of like right here next to the water. Are you going to move to somewhere else or stay there for your next... whatever you're planning on.
Let's see. Well, since I am now appearing as
there's no one near, much around you. You're about the only people down by the water, but it's certainly where people would come and get water at some point.
Okay. Kel and Celia are stealthing, so they can
I'm trying to. I'm still trying to calm myself.
Yeah, both of you guys are a bit shaken. There's also, I mean, you're in full moonlight, basically on the shore of a lake. There's not a whole lot of stuff to stealth behind right here.
The first thing I thought of. I want to be quiet. I want to.
So yeah, I mean, now certainly for keeping your voices down and making this discussion so it's not overheard, that maybe we'll call this more of a audible stealth. You do have where you are. In fact, I'll even say you've got advantage for audible things because you're next to the waterfall, and it would very much help to dampen any conversation that's happening.
Look, Goldar, there's not too well at being quiet.
I'm going to turn to Celia and say, Celia, what do you suggest we do?
It seems to be your speciality.
Celia says, we need to find this child and we need to get the fuck out of here.
By the way, just in case there's anyone who needs it, you do have a D10 healing die, which I will allow you to, anyone who would like to use it, to use from Big Bestie. She donated it back during combat, but we were right in the middle of things and I had to get through my speech and I kind of forgot about it.
Iska, I think Iska turns to Luck and says, Luck, we don't have to be quiet. Maybe you and me can go, let's go put on a show. Let's go get these people excited. Let's go get them.
Let's get some food cooking. I've got all these spices.
Exactly.
Hi. Ooh, excellent.
I can.
just to clarify, the illusion is, it is only like the illusion here. Nothing else changes, right? It's just visual?
I think that's the case. I'll double check real quick.
It's basically, it's disguise self, but it's disguise person. So it's basically being able to cast disguise self on someone else.
I'll give her some sort of clothing that isn't as monk-like. My backup shirt. You know, so she's not as, you know.
Change clothes a little bit, sure.
Yeah, not as mysterious. You don't mind wearing, the pants are probably a bit too big. Sure.
Was the healing die for everybody?
No, it was one.
So somebody.
Someone, whoever needs it.
Yeah.
I'm still pretty hurt from the temple. I have less than half my hit points, but I know Celia is in bad shape too.
So, there's
I'm at 13 out of 26.
You know, Stroth is still around as well. You can certainly talk or ask him for aid. You know that he's on your side.
Yeah.
I mean, you have lots of resources around you.
I'm at 14 out of 30, but you need it more. You take it.
So, actually, I do want to consult with Iska before we put on a bit of a show, as they say. I want to consult with one of the people here. I think we can trust him, but I will have to make sure. As I go off to find what was his name, the caravan who does all the livestock.
Tohir.
Yeah, I want to go and talk to him quickly.
Okay.
It's a D10, right?
It is a D10.
I rolled 3.
It could be. It could always be worse.
Could always be worse.
This level 3 points can definitely make a difference.
I'm down to 10 now.
Yep. So I want to go off and talk to Tohir first, and then I'll reconvene with Iska later.
Okay. Tohir is, I mean, sort of normal arrangement that you're used to of Liam's caravan. You have a lot of people around sort of the tavern cart with a larger big bonfire. Tohir, who had been hanging out with you guys, you know, pretty much, he's kind of almost expecting you since he said you gave you the directions to the Tears of Tiamat in the first place, has, you know, made his fire a little larger and with a nice clearing around it, kind of expecting you guys for dinner. As you head over to him, you do see what was, you know, almost as you sit down at first was kind of Topor, kind of half-masked eyes sort of comes back up into doing his